Good morning.
Good morning.
Let me welcome you to St. Martin's in the Field, or actually you should welcome me, I suppose. I'm Bruce McPherson, to those of you that I don't know, and it's just a great joy for me to be back at St. Martin's, where I see so many old friends and old acquaintances. So, to begin the service, please join in the singing of hymn 391, Before the Lord's Eternal. The service continues in the prayer book on page 355. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Almighty God, the fountain of all wisdom, You know our necessities before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Have compassion on our weakness and mercifully give us those things which for our unworthiness we dare not and for our blindness we cannot ask. Through the worthiness of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel, and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts. I am the first, and I am the last. Besides me, there is no God. Who is like me? Let them proclaim it. Let them declare and set it forth before me. Who has announced from of old the things to come? Let them tell us what is yet to be. Do not fear or be afraid. Have I not told you from of old and declared it? You are my witnesses. Is there any God besides me? There is no other rock. I know not one. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in praying a portion of Psalm 86. Teach me your way,
O Lord, and I will walk in your truth. Give my heart to you, that I may fear your name. I will thank you, O Lord, my God, with all my heart, and glorify your name forevermore. For great is your love toward me. You have delivered me from the nethermost pit. The arrogant rise up against me, O God, and a man of violent events.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit are the children of God. For you do not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if we are children, then also heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If, in fact, we suffer with him so that we may be also glorified with him. I consider the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. For the creation waits in eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. For the creation was subjugated to futility, not on its own will, but by the will who subjugated it. It is the hope of creation itself that it will be set free from its bondage to decay and will obtain the freedom of glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who are the first fruits of the Spirit, groaning inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope we were saved. Now that hope that is not seen is not hope. For who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Christ.
Another parable Jesus put before the crowds. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sowed good seed in his field, but while everyone was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and then went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, "Master, did you not sow good seed in the field? Where then did these weeds come from?" He answered, "An enemy has done this." The slaves said to him, "Then do you want us to go and gather them?" But he replied, "No, for in gathering the weeds, you could uproot the wheat along with them. Let both of them grow together until the harvest. And at harvest time, I will tell the reapers, 'Collect the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn.'" Then he left the crowds and went into the house. And his disciples approached him, saying, "Explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field." He answered, "The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so will it be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all evildoers, and they will throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun and in the kingdom of their Father." Let anyone with ears listen. The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Can you all hear me? You sure? Okay, if that changes, please let me know. The last thing I want to do is go up there. But I will. So I brought with me a book recommendation for your summer reading. This one was recommended to me by my wife, and she was right for once. Irresistible. This book is called Once Upon a Wardrobe, and it's written by Patty Callahan. If you have any working knowledge of C.S. Lewis and his Narnia Chronicles, the first book in that series is the Witch and the Wardrobe. And Lion, the Witch, thank you very much. Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. This book is a fictionalized discussion between a graduate student in mathematics at Oxford University and C.S. Lewis, who is there as a lecturer in literature. The book is way better than I'm about to make. So the plot is far more interesting than this, but that's the heart of it. And of course the question is, is Narnia real? Is it just a made up thing to entertain kids, or is it real? And C.S. Lewis, of course, takes the position that, paraphrasing Einstein, that logic will get you from A to B, but it won't tell you the meaning of anything. So I want to say a word about stories today and the power that stories have for us in our daily lives. Jesus told stories all the time, you know that. Stories called parables. Sometimes short, sometimes extended metaphors about what Jesus called the kingdom of God. Scholars debate what he meant by that. He might have meant heaven somewhere in the afterlife. Certainly in today's lesson, it sounds like that. Or he might have meant something closer to home, something more in the here and now. At one point he said, the kingdom of God is among us. Might even have said within us. Depends on how you translate it. So in a way, if the kingdom of God is about then and there, there's not an awful lot you and I can do about it. I mean, we can do what my mother always said, and that was behave yourself. On the other hand, if the kingdom of God is in the here and now, then we have a lot to learn. And the parables tell us a lot about that way of living, if you will, that Jesus called the kingdom of God. There's an old Jewish approach to understanding biblical stories that says that there are four layers, if you will, to the story. The outer layer is just the facts of the story. Jesus said that a farmer went out and he planted seed, and that night somebody, some bad guy came and planted weeds, and then when they started to grow, the farm workers said, you got weeds in there, shouldn't we pull them out? And the farmer said, no, let them grow. And then when we're sure which is a weed and which is wheat, then we can begin to pull them out. And then paragraph two, it goes into the house, and the disciples say, well, what does that mean? And he said, well, it's about the end of time. It's about judgment day, when the Son of Man will come and decide which is wheat and which is weed, and the weeds will burn in the fiery furnace forever, and the wheat will be gathered into God's eternal kingdom. Now, the use of the Son of Man in that gives you a tip that there's more going on here than meets the eye. And so phase two, or level two, is what do scholars say about it? And scholars say, well, the fact that the Son of Man is referenced, when Jesus refers to himself as the Son of Man, is a reference to the apocalypse, a reference to that time, specifically in the book of Daniel, when the Son of Man comes and takes charge of everything. So it's from an apocalyptic kind of genre. And at the time, in Jesus' day, and in the time of the evangelists, the people who wrote the Gospels, the idea that the end is near was very prevalent. It was in the air. Everybody thought that there was coming very soon a day of reckoning when the wicked would be punished and the righteous would be lifted up and honored. That day is long gone for us. And scholars say paragraph 2 was probably written by Matthew. Is a way of explaining to his congregation, his community, what did Jesus really mean, and interpreting it in the framework of this apocalyptic end of times scenario. Paragraph 1 is also repeated in another gospel that's not in the Bible, so probably has something to do with Jesus. The third level is, what does it mean to you and me? What's the takeaway? When you hear a story like this, or the story of the lost sheep, or the story of a prodigal son, or the story of a hated but nonetheless good Samaritan, what do you make of it? What does it mean to you? I have to say, the apocalyptic imagery means nothing to me. I just don't relate to it. I mean, I don't have all that many more years left, so you guys may have to suffer through it, not me. But the facts are that we've been waiting for a long, long time for them. And now I'm seeing some not very well put together ideas about spaceships coming to rescue us and things. I don't think the apocalyptic literature means very much at all. So what does the basic story mean to me or to you? I have to think about it a little bit. But maybe it means that the world we live in is filled with moral ambiguity. It's really hard sometimes to know what's a weed and what's wheat. You can't always tell for sure. And it's something we all moral ambiguity is something we all struggle with great regularity. Should I spend more time with my family, or should I work harder in order to support my family in the way to which I'd like to support them? I have a cousin who I think the world of. Great guy. Known him literally both of our entire lives. But we agree about absolutely nothing. There is not a single thing that I can think of that we agree about. Whether it's sports, or whether it's movies, or I'm not going to say the word politics, but that may enter into it. We agree about how am I to manage, how am I to navigate that relationship? A grandchild came out to me two or three years ago as gender neutral. I'm old. I don't know from gender neutral. But I want to know, and I want to know how to handle that. what's the right reaction morally? What am I to do? Moral ambiguity is just part of life, don't you agree? I mean, we all struggle with issues that are hard to resolve. And I think it's fair to say that in the struggle, that's how we grow. That's how we mature. So I think this story of the wheat and the weeds has something to do with our lives that are filled with moral dilemmas. I agree. The fourth layer, the core of the story, what lies deep within every story, is the mystery. It's the one thing worth everything. It's what we struggle to try to understand, what we try to find, why we pay attention to these stories. If we do that, we discover over time that they're changing our lives, that these stories are changing us. The C.S. Lewis character says in here, every life should be guided and enriched by story, one story or another. Certainly every formative moment in my life has been enriched and formed by a good story. But you must be careful what you read unless you want to stay stuck in your opinions and hard-boiled thoughts. Well, I don't want to be stuck in my opinions and hard-boiled thoughts. I want to be open. I think you do too. And so the stories guide us into a more, they enrich our moral imagination, if you will. Give us guideposts. Give us ideas to fall back on when we're not entirely sure what is the right thing to do. That's why we read them. That's why we study them. And they were true 2,000 years ago, just as they are true today. The great Irish poet John O'Donohue, well, I'll paraphrase what he said. He said, a parable is a path of words that takes our hearts in new directions. A parable is a path of words that takes our hearts in new directions. This parable may be saying to us, sometimes we should withhold judgment. Sometimes we should hold on to our preconceived ideas very, very lightly. Because sometimes what looks like a weed turns out to be wheat. Sometimes what looks like a really good thing turns out to be painful and destructive. And we really don't know unless we allow whatever it is to mature. Whatever the thought is, whatever the concept is, whatever the idea is, sometimes you have to let it cook a little while. But pay attention, because there will come a day when you have to harvest. And on that day, it's important to know what's a good idea and what's a bad idea. What's evil and what's productive, good, healthy. That's why we read these stories. That's why we try to internalize these stories. That's why they're so important for us and for our grandchildren and for their grandchildren. Amen. Let us stand now and affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen.
The prayers of the people are Form 6 on page 392. In peace we pray to you, Lord God. For all people in their daily life and work.
For our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are lost.
For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble, especially Chris, Jax, Roslyn, Tina, Sumner, Sarah, and Lee. For those for the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Eugene, our bishop, Carrie, our bishop-elect, for Nathan, our clergy, and Tony, our head of school. In the Anglican cycle of prayer this week, we pray for the Church of the Province of Central Africa, and in our diocesan cycle of prayer, we pray for St. Andrew's, Pasadena, St. Luke's, Eastport, and St. Margaret's, Annapolis, and for all bishops and other ministers. We now lift up to God the special needs and concerns of our congregation, praying either aloud or silently in our hearts. Hear us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. For all in our parish family who celebrate birthdays this week, Alexander, Daniel, Jason, Hunter, Jeremy, and Cindy. We will exalt you, O God our King.
and praise his name forever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them
who put their trust in you.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us,
most merciful God. In your compassion, forgive us our sins.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Let us now greet each other with a sign of God's peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Please be seated. I have no announcements. Darren?
Good morning. I'm Darren, and I'm your senior warden. Before I get into some of the announcements, can you please join me in thanking Bruce for being here? For those of you who are relatively new, say post-Matthew, Bruce was our interim rector and helped us reach this place, and he has graciously accepted the role of being our consultant and mentor in this process. Okay, so let's get to some announcements. Wednesday, Korean barbecue is on the docket for Wednesday at 6 o'clock, so please come. And Haesung has some good things planned. Oh, there she is. Did you want to make the announcement, Haesung? You can tell them what's on the menu.
Good morning, St. Martin's. It's really good to see your faces down here this morning. It's been a quite exciting summer music-wise at St. Martin's, and there's more to come, so I'd like to share some information with you. First of all, next Sunday, July the 30th, we will have a guest violinist, Dr. Aaron Kim, and then she and I will play some movements by Bach and Beethoven's violin sonatas. And as you know, Bach and Beethoven, they're probably the most representative composers from Baroque and classical period. And you'll be able to hear the quite different stylistic approaches in terms of the way to manage the sound, formal structures, techniques, and also the ensemble between piano and violin. But regardless of all of these theoretical aspects, they're just really gorgeous pieces. We've been rehearsing here, and especially in this sanctuary, the chamber music just carries us so nicely. So we are very looking forward to sharing this beautiful music with you. And that will be also a preview of our summer concert, which will be held on Sunday, August 27th at 4 p.m. So please mark on your calendar. And a week after, the August 6th, that's the Sunday that we're changing the service time to 10 a.m. I'm sure you're about to mention it. But it's also the Transfiguration Sunday. So I am preparing some special music for the Sunday as well by Franz Liszt. Franz Liszt is a really interesting composer. He was one of the most celebrated pianists in the 19th century, and then he had a quite flamboyant and unconventional early life. He was like Elvis Presley in their time. Like he was just like so popular that the ladies loved him. But he was always religious, and then in his like later 50s, he was ordained. Not really ordained, but like he got minor orders from Catholic Church. He was acolyte, exorcist, lector, and a porter. And he was called Abbey List after his minor ordination. So he wrote many religious pieces, like oratorios, chorale, and of course piano and organ pieces. So I'm gonna play a couple of piano pieces, and also Melanie and Lori will sing a song, which is also written by Liszt that day. So it's gonna be fantastic. After that Sunday, I'll be gone for vacation for 2 weeks, and we will have guest organist, Merjana, who played last month, and then she will provide like beautiful service music. And also Aaron will play his handbell solo with like 20 bells by himself, so you don't want to miss that. And after that Sunday, I'll be back on the 27th, and then that's the day for the summer concert. So as you can see, there are a lot going on every week, so please don't miss any Sunday. And finally, this coming Wednesday, I'll be in charge of running Meet and Eat, and then we'll do some Korean barbecue. So yeah, of course, Korean barbecue is the best on the charcoal grill. I'll bring some pork belly, marinated pork butt, and also Korean spicy cold buckwheat noodle salad. I'm sure you never had it before, eh? So yeah, it's gonna be fun and delicious, so hope many of you can join us. Thank you.
Thank you. As the reigning lemonade making champion too, I wonder, hey Sung, are you going to bring your trophy winning lemonade to Wednesday as well? I don't want to put too much on your schedule there. So as Hey Sung said, on the 6th of August, we are moving to a 10 a.m. service, and that is also the very first service where our new interim rector, Joshua Rodriguez Hobbs, will be preaching on Sunday the 6th, so please be sure to make it for that. One last announcement, August 4th is pizza night at the Lighthouse Shelter, so if you haven't signed up, please do so. All right, thank you.
Thank you. There's always a lot going on at St. Martin's in the Field. Just a word for me, and that is that hymn 481 is not hymn 481. You're all misreading it. It's actually hymn 482. That's the offertory. What follows now is Holy Communion. All those who seek a closer relationship with God in Christ are invited to receive. Walk in love, as Christ loved us and gave himself for us an offering as a sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
service continues in the prayer book on page 369 with Eucharistic Prayer C. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
God of all power, ruler of the universe, you are worthy of glory and praise. At your command, all things came to be. The vast expanse of interstellar space, galaxies, suns, the planets in their courses, and this fragile earth, our island home.
By your will, they were created and have their being.
From the primal elements, you brought forth the human race and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the rulers of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust and returned against one another.
Have mercy, Lord,
for we are sinners. Again and again you called us to return. Through the prophets and sages you revealed your righteous law, and in the fullness of time you sent your Son, born of a woman, to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace.
By his blood you reconciled us, by his wounds we are healed.
Therefore we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope, to proclaim with them your glory in their unending hymn. So, O God, we who have been redeemed by him and made a new people by water and the Spirit, now bring before you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering now his work of redemption and offering to you this sacrifice of thanksgiving, we celebrate his death and resurrection as we await the day of his coming. Lord God of our fathers, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God of Sarah, Ruth, and Mary, God and creator of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength, for pardon only and not for renewal. That the grace of this holy communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name. Risen Lord, be known to us in the breaking of the bread. Accept these prayers and praises, O God, through Jesus Christ, our great high priest, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit your church gives honor, glory, and worship from generation to generation.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feel him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, and you fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us
strength and courage to love and serve you
with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Now the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and forevermore.